next speaker of the Young Speakers Contest, and that is Thijs van Eeden. So I'm going to give you the floor, Thijs.
So, good afternoon, everybody. Let me wait for my slides. Okay. So, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Thijs van Eeden, and I'm a particle physicist working at the NICEF Institute in Amsterdam. So, today I want to explain to you how we learn more about the most distant and mysterious objects in our universe by looking at particles at the bottom of the Mediterranean Sea. To understand how we end up at the bottom of the sea, we need to go back in time. So for as long as we humans walk this planet, we look up to the sky, we see the stars, and we catch a glimpse of our universe. Nowadays, we know there's a lot more to the universe than the eye can see. We are continuously bombarded with energetic particles and radiation coming from outer space. The puzzling thing, these particles can be a million times more energetic than the particles in our most powerful particle accelerator here on Earth, the LHC at CERN in Geneva. What kind of objects can create these extremely energetic particles? My work is focused on finding their origin. So why haven't we found their origin yet? Let's take a look at the mysterious object somewhere far away. Traditional astronomers would look at the light this object is emitting. But if this object is very far away, we run into problems because if light hits matter on the way, it interacts, and then we don't see it here on Earth. The majority of particles that arrive here on our planet are charged, but charged particles follow a curved trajectory due to the magnetic fields present in our universe. And when we detect them here on Earth, it's difficult to point back to where they came from. So today I want to present you the solution, and that is the detection of neutrinos. Neutrinos are chargeless particles, and therefore they travel through a universe in a straight line. They're famous for their tiny, tiny interaction probability, so they can travel through dense areas of space without interacting. And this makes them the perfect messenger from these mysterious and distant objects. The majority of neutrinos pass right through our planet. They pass through you, they pass through me, but one in a billion interacts. So let's take a look at a neutrino entering one of our oceans. If this neutrino interacts, it will produce a charged particle. These charged particles do something very interesting because they go so fast that they exceed the speed of light in water. This produces a shockwave of light that we can actually see. We can compare this optical effect with a similar acoustic effect that everybody knows. If a plane travels through our sky and it exceeds the speed of sound, the sound waves bunch up behind the plane, forming a shockwave. And when this plane passes you, you don't hear anything. And then suddenly the shockwave catches up with you and hits your eardrum with a very loud bang. We have something similar happening underwater, but then with light instead of sound. So we have these neutrinos flying through our universe. They pass our planet, and every once in a while, they show us a faint light. What can we do with this? If you want to detect this light, we need to build an extremely large detector because these interactions of neutrinos are extremely rare. The perfect place for something like this? The bottom of the Mediterranean Sea. Researchers and scientists from all these countries are working together to build a neutrino telescope. The name of the telescope is KM3NET, and it's being constructed at the bottom of the Mediterranean Sea near Sicily, where this black star is. If we go below the surface near Sicily, we find our detector at 3.5 kilometers in depth. The detector consists of a cubic kilometer of seawater that's instrumented with very sensitive light sensors. These light sensors are placed within glass spheres. And if we take a look at one of these glass spheres, You see 31 eyes, and these eyes are the sensitive light sensors that can detect single photons. We place these glass spheres in a three-dimensional grid at the bottom of the sea. And if you take a look at a sketch of how our final detector would look like, you see over 2,000 of these glass spheres here. And now, if a neutrino interacts in the vicinity of our detector and a charged particle enters it, you can see a trail of light that will be detected by our sensors. Our sensors detect light at the bottom of the sea, and they send the data to shore. The data consists of two things: the time at which light was detected and the position of the sensor that actually saw the light. So when this data reaches shore, it is sent to my home office. This is where I work, probably like the rest of you as well, working from home. And here I work on algorithms that translate this data, translate these light patterns to the direction of the particle that produced it. It's important that this is done very efficiently because we get tons and tons of data from the sea. And secondly, we need to make this translation as good as possible because the better we determine the direction of the particle, the better we can determine its origin. So how do I do this? Let's take a look at an example. We have our detector, a charged particle produces light, and our sensors, they see it. In real life, we don't see the direction of the particle, we only see the light that is detected. How do we make this translation from light patterns to the direction? The key to this is doing extensive simulations. In my work, I simulate particles and light underwater, and I try to get an idea of how much light a sensor of us would see if a particle passes by. In these simulations, we find out that the amount of light depends, for example, on the distance of our sensor to the trajectory of the particle, the energy of the particle, the water properties, and these simulations together provide us a probability that our sensor would see light depending on what happens in our detector. These probabilities are the key to translating the data that we get from the sea to the direction of the particle. So let's go back to our detector. We have this light pattern and we want to figure out the direction of the particle that caused it. What I do, I hypothesize a direction of a particle and figuring out, is this the direction that produced this light pattern? What I do then is I calculate for all the sensors the probability that this sensor would see light if a particle passed in this direction. When I have these probabilities, I can multiply them to get a likelihood that this light pattern was produced by a particle going in this direction. I repeat this process for a different direction. I obtain new probabilities, a new likelihood, and I could do this for a whole bunch of directions. And I compare these likelihoods and I pick the direction that has the highest likelihood, telling me that this light pattern was produced by a particle going in that direction. So the algorithms that I write, they typically give an estimation of the direction of the particle. So let's pretend that this is my estimation of the direction of the particle, where the triangle represents the error. If we map this direction onto a sky map, you see that it's a huge part of the sky from where this particle could have come from. There could be millions of objects there that could have produced this particle. It's therefore very important to make this translation as precise as possible. In our detector, we can actually pinpoint the direction of particles like this. And the key to that are those simulations that I talked about. The better we understand particles in our detector, light, and everything that happens underwater there, the better we can make this translation from light to a direction. And then we can pinpoint an origin of a particle on the sky map like this. And when we can do it like this, we are in an excellent position to work together with scientists and astronomers around the world to figure out what kind of objects are there that are creating these particles. And hopefully this will help us to solve the mystery surrounding these extremely energetic particles flying around in our universe. So today I gave you an overview of my work and what we're trying to learn about the universe at the bottom of the Mediterranean Sea. I hope that when this curfew is over, You're allowed to go out again at night. You take a night stroll, you look up to the sky, and you remember, there's more to the universe than the eye can see. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Thijs. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. And luckily, even within the curfew, when you're at home, neutrinos will always bombard you wherever you are.